Today's webinar is about capacity design of SCD plywood shear walls, and it's based on a worked example. And it was on the request essentially of Engineering New Zealand and engineering general practitioners saying we need someone who can cover the basics of a shear wall design. Now, before we go into the details, I want to quickly thank our TDS sponsors who are always supporting us as the society as well. So we have MyTech, Simpson Strongtie, FutureBuild LVL, Ixdam, iBuild, and also Rotoblast, who are our sponsors. And always Engineering New Zealand with Caitlin and Nicola today, helping us with setting up this webinars and doing also the comms. We won't have any webinar in January because we all want to enjoy our annual leave, our Christmas leave. And we are back on the 24th of February with the moisture management guideline, which is worked on by Björn Stankowitz at Timbra Limited. And moving forward, we will then announce new speakers. If you have any topic of interest, you would like someone to talk, or you actually want to talk, please contact us, Timbra Design Society. We would be more than welcome to take your our thoughts on board, obviously. As Nicola was saying, please pop your questions in the Q&A session further down. Right, back to today's webinar and Jay. So today's webinar will demonstrate the capacity design of limited ductile LTF plywood shear walls, which is following the multi-story light timber framing guideline, which is published by Brands in 2019. The concept in the design guide will be briefly introduced and demonstrated through a worked example, stepping through the ULS design of a single story wall. So Jay discussed this a little bit with me of what is going to cover. So today is mainly about ULS design, and a future webinar will then cover more detail the SLS or the deflection design moving forward. So Jay is a senior structural engineer at Sylvester Clark, with experience in designing multi-story buildings and engineered timber in Wellington, utilizing system including light timber frame plywood shear walls with continuous tie rod systems and cross-laminated timber shear walls. Jay has also keen interest in engineering timber structures, in particular to the lower environmental impact, biophilic appeal, and versatility, even in moderate seismic areas. So it's my pleasure to have Jay leading this webinar today. I've worked with him over the last years, and I'm looking forward to his presentation today. Jay, thank you very much. Over to you.
Thank you very much, Daniel, and good afternoon, everyone. So as Daniel said, I am Jay Aumann. I'm a senior structural engineer at Sylvester Clark here in Christchurch. And today my talk will cover the capacity design of specific engineering design plywood shear walls. In particular, I'll talk about some of the key aspects of seismic design in New Zealand Standard 1720, which is the new timber design standard that replaced 3603. And then I'll demonstrate the application of the principles through a worked example. To give you a brief outline of what I'll be talking about, I'll start by introducing the components in a light timber framed plywood shear wall. I'll introduce the key seismic design requirements specifically in the context of LTF walls, and then I'll very simplistically illustrate the approach to designing these walls. I'll then discuss the different sources of deformations and how to calculate them. And finally, I'll step through a worked example to show how you might undertake the design of a limited ductile single story wall. So what is a light timber framed plywood shear wall? Consider a typical single story LTF wall. This is the type of framing that you see in New Zealand all across the country. You have a roof or a suspended floor supported on a top plate with studs, a bottom plate, and a foundation. Specific engineered plywood shear walls tend to pick up larger loads than what you might see from plasterboard walls. And to allow for the larger loads to be resisted, the cords at the end of the walls are typically a little bit larger than the internal studs. To take any uplift demands down to the foundation, there are usually discrete connectors attached to these end studs that anchor down into the ground. You then have your plywood sheathing, which provides the shear stiffness in plane of your wall, and the nailing attaches that plywood sheathing to your framing. It's important to specify that the nailing that we're talking about here is the edge nailing along the main perimeter of your plywood sheets, not the internal ones, which provide nominal fixing to your internal studs and dwellings. The nails in this system provide the ductility globally. So that ductility is achieved by cyclic yielding of the nail, as well as local embedment crushing of the surrounding timber. So under lateral loading, an overturning moment is generated and a force couple is induced at each of the cords. The tension connector provides the hold down resistance, while the compression toe provides perpendicular to grain stiffness under compression. Then you have your bottom anchors resisting base shear. So, what are the requirements for seismic design of plywood shear walls according to the new timber design standard? Capacity design is required for nominally ductile and limited ductile systems. 1720 allows for ductilities of up to 3 to be designed. Any larger than that, you'll have to consider an alternative solution or a special study. In light timber framing specifically, nailing of the ply is typically designated to be the yielding element. So this is the element that provides all the ductility in our system, and all the inelastic deformation is concentrated within the nailing. All other components within the wall system then, such as your cords, your top and bottom plate, your plywood sheathing, all the base connectors, and any brittle failure modes of fastener groups are designed to resist the overstrength actions that are able to be developed in your perimeter nailing. So 1720 introduces the concept of a PDE and a CPE, PDE being your potential ductile elements, and CPE being your capacity protected elements. Seventeen twenty also requires that local deformation demands in your PDEs to be verified. That is, we would need to quantify the displacement demand at the nails and check it against prescribed limits. Specifically for nails, the deformation limit is 6 millimeters under lateral loading. Finally, it is worth mentioning that 1720 allows upper limit actions to be considered. So for cases where you provide capacity in your nailing in excess of what is required for your ductile demand, overstrength demands arising from those connections can be quite large. 1720 technically allows you to cut off the demand that you design your CPEs to the demands arising from an elastic level of loading, but it's worth reminding people to exercise caution in applying these upper limits, as it can invalidate the intended inelastic response of your system. So you may not be able to achieve the mechanism that you've designed in and reach the ductility that you've originally intended in your design. So what's a typical design approach for the ultimate limit state? This will be a simplified flowchart, but hopefully illustrates in a chronological way the approach that you can take in a step-by-step manner. So to start with, you assume a building period and a ductility. You analyze the structure, and then you apportion story shear to individual walls. So this is classic structural analysis, nothing special, nothing unique compared to, say, standard multi-story steel or concrete design. There is a concept of shear flow, which is essentially just the shear apportioned to a single wall divided by its length. So the shear demand at every wall is represented by a kilonewton per meter value. Based on that shear flow, we then design our fasteners, so our PDEs. We decide on a fastener size and spacing, and from that, we can calculate the maximum overstrength that's able to be developed within our nails. At this point, we ignore the actions generated from our original analysis on our CPEs and instead recalculate overstrength demands or capacity protected demands when we dimension and when we size our sheathing, our cords, and our connectors. Following that, we quantify all the component deformations and we scale these to ULS. Knowing our ultimate displacement and knowing that our nails provide all the inelastic deformation, we can calculate the fastener local deformation demand and check it against the prescribed limits in 1720. If limits are not satisfied, we will then have to go back and resize our fasteners, adjust the spacing, and repeat the process of calculating the overstrength shear flow and resizing all our CPEs for the adjusted overstrength. The final step, which probably matters more for multi-story plywood shear walls, is to review the period and loading based on the actual system properties. So what I'm trying to say here is, given that you've assumed an original period to start with to work out your demands, and following confirmation of the dimensions and the stiffness in your building, it would be prudent to calculate the period and the loading using the actual stiffness properties to confirm those original assumptions. So I won't go through with the strength design, since this is just general timber design checks according to 1720, which are similar to 3603 with slightly modified equations. Instead, I will try and talk through all the sources of deformation in a plywood shear wall. So it's important to point out that the deformations that I'm showing here are the ones that are described in the Brand's multi-story light timber framed engineering design guide, which will be the main source of reference for all the material going forward. NZS 1720 actually has its own breakdown of wall deformation sources as well. However, I find that the Brand's guide more descriptively breaks these down and shows in a step-by-step manner how each might be calculated. So to start, delta 1 and delta 2 are simply the chord flexural deformations due to shear and overturning moment at the top of the wall. Delta 3 is the panel shear deformation of your plywood sheathing, which is essentially just the shear distortion of your plywood. Delta 4 is the deformation due to fastener slip. So this is the flexibility arising from your nails yielding along the plywood edges. And that considers any internal joints that you might have in the plywood. Delta 5 is the deformation of your wall due to anchorage system flexibility. So at your tension connector end, there will be some elongation that may occur under tension. And at your compression toe end, there will be some local vertical settlement due to perpendicular to grain bearing at your bottom plate. Finally, delta 6 is the cumulative rotation of the walls below. So this is zero for single story walls, and it essentially talks about the, or essentially considers the pre-rotation of the walls below the one that you are currently assessing. And I'll talk a little bit more about that later on. So delta 1, 2, and 3 are fairly self-explanatory. The equations are shown here, and I suggest not worrying about what the variables in these equations mean at this stage. I'll demonstrate that later on in the worked example, and I'll show that hopefully a lot of these numbers, they're very easily obtained from either timber design standard, from supplier technical literature, or from your demands. So I'll go into a little bit more detail about the deformation due to fastener slip, delta 4. So this is one of the major sources of deformation. As I mentioned before, all the inelastic deformation comes from nail slip. The equation is shown at the bottom there. Delta 4 being the deformation due to nail slip, L being the length of your wall, H being the height of your wall, N is simply the number of internal plywood splices that's parallel to your wall length. So this is the number of horizontal joints. M is the number of splices parallel to your wall height. So that's the number of vertical joints. ENI is just the deformation of a single nail under lateral loading. So to work out the deformation of a single nail, we know the load to start with. We need an understanding of what the stiffness of the nail is. And that's represented by this term here, K-SIR or K-serviceability. So if I break this equation down further, VI is the shear demand in the wall, L is the length of the wall, so VI over L is just your shear flow. That gives you a shear demand in kilonewtons per meter. SI is the spacing of your nails, so multiplying your shear flow by the spacing gives you the demand on a single nail. And given the stiffness, we can then work out what the deformation of the nail is. So how do we work out the stiffness? We can either calculate the actual deformation on the nail given a specific level of loading using 1720, which is shown on the top right there. Alternatively, we could also use simplified empirical equations, say from the Eurocode, which typically provide very straightforward, easy to use equations that we could use in our displacement assessment. So the table shown below, for example, you can see taken from the Eurocode 5, the bottom row gives us a K-SIR for nails without pre-drilling. And that's only dependent on the mean density of the material that you are embedding your nail into and the diameter of the nail. Because these are stiffnesses provided at serviceability limit state, and we are designing at ULS for some ductility, we have to reduce that stiffness to account for a reduced stiffness in the post-yield state. And that's done by simply applying a reduction factor of two-thirds to the SLS or to the serviceability stiffness. If you calculate your stiffness directly from 1720 from the curve provided, you don't need to apply that reduction factor since you are already accounting for the local stiffness at the level of loading that you're considering. So you are already on that curve. Next, delta 5, the anchorage system deformation, can also be another major source of deformation. This is especially critical in multi-story timber framed walls. It also requires the calculation of the stiffness of your tension connector as well as the compression or the bearing stiffness at your compression toe. The equation for delta 5 is idealized as the height of the wall times a rotation at the base. And the rotation at the base is again simply just your moment divided by a rotational stiffness. This expression here, or the inverse of this expression here, gives you that rotational stiffness. LC being simply the distance from your compression centroid of your compression cord to your tension connector. KT is the stiffness of your tension bracket, and KC is the stiffness of your compression toe. So before I move on to that, the stiffness of the compression toe can be easily calculated with this equation here, provided in the Brands Guide. E90 is the short-term modulus of elasticity perpendicular to the grain. So we know that SG8 has an E parallel to grain of 8,000. E90 is typically approximated by taking 1/15th of that value. So that gives you about 533 for standard timber framing. AP is the area of, is the bearing area. So the area of the footprint of your compression cord into your bottom plate, and HC is simply the height of your bottom plate. The Brands Guide also allows for a correction factor to be applied in the form of this eta value. Eta C, which is a correction factor for compression toes on a continuous support, is given by that equation here, which is only dependent on the width of your compression toe and the height of your bottom plate. Similarly, E to D is used for discrete supports and is dependent on the same variables. So you typically use continuous support conditions when you are, say, at a foundation where you have a continuous bearing support and you have a little bit more of a spread of load compared to, say, for example, some part up the height of your building where you have studs landing on a bottom plate, landing on a floor, then landing on studs again. So the stress spreading that occurs in those different conditions vary a little bit, and that's considered by these correction factors. For your tension stiffness, you could either calculate it from first principles by taking the stiffness of an individual nail, for example, and multiplying it by the number of nails. However, it's probably better to use, if you are using an off-the-shelf type of connector, manufacturers typically provide stiffness values in their technical literature. So what I'm showing here, for example, is the WHT. That's stiffness values from Rotoblast. You could take these values from the manufacturer test reports. Because these connectors are not designed to yield in our plywood shear walls, we can use the initial stiffness or the serviceability limit state stiffness instead of reducing it. If you're looking at multi-story construction, it's important to consider the effects of tension hold downs in series. So if you think about a multi-story wall stack with a continuous rod to provide hold down, the rod will be stiffer at ground level, where it's anchored to very rigid foundations or a very rigid beam, for example, versus at the top floor, where any elongation in the rod at that floor will be influenced by any previous elongation in the floors below. And that's accounted for by simply taking the inverse of the sum of the inverses of all the different components that might be contributing to that tension stiffness. There is a worked example in the Brand's Guide that steps through the calculation of the stiffness in series. So readers could refer to that for a multi-story design. Finally, we've got the cumulative rotation of supporting walls, which, as I mentioned, only really applies for multi-story walls. And I like to think of it as a pre-rotation of the supporting wall. So if we think about it, deltas 1 to 5, so the first five components of deformation, they consider a fixed frame of reference for the displacements. So it only considers the base where it is and calculates the displacement at the roof or at the top of the wall. This term considers that in multi-story buildings, the wall supporting the wall that you're looking at will already be in a pre-rotated state. And it's typically calculated by simply using the rotation that you've calculated in delta 5, as well as some additional rotation due to shear and flexure. Again, the worked example in the Brand's Guide steps through a four-story building, four-story wall stack that goes through the calculation of these terms. So knowing all the sources of deformation, we are now in a position to calculate the overall displacement demand in our building. It's important to note that all the displacements that we've calculated so far are elastic and have not yet been adjusted to the ultimate limit state. So our elastic displacement is simply the sum of deltas 1 to 6. And NZS 1720 requires us to consider that in timber structures, typically, the energy dissipation is reduced or is less than what you would see from a concrete or steel structure. It requires us to consider the effects of that reduced energy dissipation on the deformation at ultimate limit state. It suggests a couple of different references down here on how that might be done, but the Brand's Guide suggests a much more straightforward way to account for it. And that's with the use of this additional coefficient KDT. So in normal portal frame design, for example, in steel, we would merely just scale our elastic displacement by our design ductility to get the ultimate displacement. To account for the reduced energy dissipation and the consequent increase in displacement, we use this factor KDT, which is simply calculated by the square root of your ductility. It's important to note that KDT does not replace the displacement modifiers that are in 1170. So if you're using the equivalent static method to analyze your wall, you would need to scale your resulting displacement profile by the KD values in 1170. And if you're looking at interstory drifts, you would also have to scale these by KDM. So knowing the ultimate displacement, we are now in a position to calculate the individual, the local displacement demand in our nails. So as we mentioned before, the only source of inelastic deformation in the walls is coming from nail slip. So if we just simply take the difference between the ultimate and the elastic displacements, that will give us the inelastic component of displacement, which we assign a symbol delta 4 for nail slip and mu for ductility. So this is the inelastic component of your global displacement. The total displacement demand, or the ultimate displacement demand for your fasteners, is then simply the sum of the elastic component of your nail displacement plus the inelastic component. So the elastic component is what we calculated originally in delta 4. The inelastic component is the difference between your ultimate displacement and your total inelastic display total elastic displacement. From that, we just rearrange the equation for delta 4 to work out the lateral deformation demand on each nail. So this is the value that we need to check against that 6 millimeter maximum limit in 1720, in addition to checking any global displacements and drift limits. If all the limits are satisfied, then that's the completion of our design. And I know that there's a lot of equations being thrown around here, so I think it might be easiest if we very quickly step through a worked example. Now this will be quite simplified, and the intention is to demonstrate the key steps that you might undertake in the design. For more information, you can refer to the Brands Guide, which does a four-story wall stack. There's also a technical note that we've published in the Timber Design Journal, volume 30, that steps through a three-story wall. So again, the focus of this work example is on the steps that are unique to plywood shear walls rather than a step-by-step implementation of the provisions of 1720. So for example, your standard ply strength check or your end cords or stud tension compression checks, we won't go through all that level of detail. That's standard timber design. And for the sake of brevity, we will simplify some of the modification factors. So consider a single story wall with a length of 3 meters and a height of 2400 millimeters. We will design for a ductility of 2 at ULS. And say after all our analysis, we find that for the particular wall that we're looking at, the shear demand or the input force is 20 kilonewtons. Let's further assume that the gravity from our gravity analysis, our end cords are subject to a gravity seismic combination compression load of 6 kilonewtons. So that's the geometry of our wall there. So we will look to use SG8 timber framing, grade 8 F8 plywood sheathing, 2.8 by 60 nails, and we'll use a non-specific proprietary hole down bracket. This is a made-up bracket called XHD24 with an ultimate capacity of 24 kilonewtons with a strength reduction factor of 1 applied to it and a stiffness of 30 kilonewtons per millimeter. I'd just like to point out that all the numbers in black are either numbers that you get directly from the standard, so it's provided in 1720, or from Australian Standard 2334 for nails. And the numbers in red, say for example, the short-term MOE perp to grain, or E90, as I mentioned before, a widely accepted approximation for this value is simply to take the parallel to grain modulus of elasticity and dividing it by 15. These values here are taken directly from supplier literature. So let's start with our PDE design, or our fasteners. The unit shear force acting along the wall edges, or the shear flow, is simply the shear force divided by the length of the wall. So 20 kilonewtons divided by 3 meters gives us a shear flow of 6.7 kilonewtons per meter. This is the demand we size our fasteners to. Now, I won't go through the steps in working out the lateral capacity of the nail. For people who are familiar with 1720, using the EYM equations is probably worth a seminar of its own. I know that Pierre has done one a few months ago, and I would encourage interested people in the audience to either refer to that talk or to refer to guidance from 1720. I'm putting the values of the calculations here, just in case you want to validate these later on. The main takeaway from this is for a 2.8 by 60 flathead nail with the head embedded into 9mm F8 ply and the tip embedded into SG8 timber, the design ultimate lateral strength is about 566 newtons. So let's try 100mm spacings. That gives us a number of nails of 30 along the top edge, which allows us to use a group factor of 1.2. So this group factor simply improves the strength of a group of nails, acknowledging the fact that for a group, it is less likely that they will all be reaching only their characteristic strength. It brings it closer to the average strength. So therefore, our design capacity is 566 newtons per nail divided by a nail at 100 mils times that group factor, which gives us an overall design capacity of 6.8. That only very slightly exceeds our shear flow, which is good. From that, we then calculate our overstrength shear flow. So we take our design capacity, which is 6.8. We discount the stress reduction factor of 0.8. We multiply it by the overstrength factor in 1720 for nails, which is 1.6. And then we discount the group factor as well. So the idea of the overstrength shear flow is to predict the maximum strength that each individual nail might reach and to design our CPEs against that maximum strength. That gives us an overstrength shear flow of about 11.3 kilonewtons per meter, which is nearly double of our initial shear flow. This is the value that we then design all our CPEs to. So starting with the plywood sheathing, we'll try a 9 millimeter thick grade F8 ply with an in-plane shear strength of 4.2 MPa and a shear modulus of 455 MPa. The design equation from NZS 1720 is given here. Because we are looking at overstrength conditions, we can use a strength reduction factor of 1 for capacity protected elements, load duration factor of 1 for seismic loading, a moisture content factor of 1, and a load direction factor of 1. We will also assume K12, which is the stability modification factor, to be 1 for simplicity. Plugging all those values into our design equation, we get a plywood sheathing capacity of 25.2 kilonewtons per meter, which exceeds our overstrength shear flow. Moving on to the end courts, we will assume that we will use three 90 by 45 studs at each end. And the equation to work out the incremental axial load demand in those courts is simply to take the overturning moment and divide it by the clear length between the courts. So this equation is further decomposed into the overstrength shear flow, multiplied by the length of the wall to give a force, multiplied by the height of the wall to give an overturning moment. And then that is divided by the clear length between the courts to give you a force couple in your tension and compression courts. It's important to point out that these are incremental axial forces. If you have a two-story wall, for example, you calculate delta T and delta C at each floor, and the total compression or tension demand under seismic loading at the ground floor will be the sum of the delta T at level 2 and the delta T at level 1. In this case, because we have no higher stories, the seismic component of the axial load is simply the overstrength shear flow times 3 meters, which gives us about 34 kilonewtons. Times 2.4 meters to give us the overturning moment divided by the clear length to give us 29 kilonewtons for seismic. Then we combine this with our gravity load to obtain our total core demand. So in compression, we get 29 kilonewtons plus 6 kilonewtons to give a total of 35 kilonewtons in compression. Under tension, we have 29 minus 6 kilonewtons to give us a total of 23 kilonewtons in tension. Now we work out the capacity of a single stud, and we multiply it by the number of studs to work out the compression capacity. So the design equation is there. Slenderness coefficient calculations shown here. I won't go through the calculation of those. What we find is using modification factors of 1 and a strength reduction factor of 1, the compression capacity per stud, given the lateral restraint condition and the height of the studs, is 72.9 kilonewtons. This means that for a group of three 90 by 45s, the total compression capacity of the stud group is 219 kilonewtons. We then have to compare this against the bearing capacity of the bottom plate under compression perpendicular to grain. The design equation is shown here. FP is simply your perpendicular to grain compression strength. AP is your bearing area, all your modification factors, and your stress reduction factor. We will consider no improvement to the design strength due to the dimension of the bearing area for simplicity, so we'll take K7 to be 1. Our design capacity after plugging in all the numbers is an 83.8 kilonewtons, which exceeds the maximum or the total compression capacity of 35 compression demand 35.1. Worth pointing out that bearing perpendicular to grain governs the design of the compression court. This becomes more critical the higher your wall goes. So you might end up with a certain number of studs required for compression, And you might find that you might have to double that just to get your bearing perpendicular to work. Moving on to the base connections. I'm showing a standard off-the-shelf bracket here from Simpson Strong-Tie. I'm just wanting to point out that there are lots of different components that make up this bracket. So you've got the capacity of your nails into the timber. You've got the capacity of the bracket itself, which is out of structural steel. And you've also got the capacity of the anchor embedded into your foundation. All of these have different stress reduction factors that apply to each component. And while we're doing a capacity design here, I just thought that's worth mentioning because there are some designs where you might elect to get some ductility out of these connections. Let's assume that for our made-up non-specific proprietary bracket, XHD24, that the limiting capacity is 24 kilonewtons for a strength reduction factor of 1. This means that we are just exceeding our total tension demand, so our connection is okay. I also want to point out that if we have multiple studs forming our cords at the end, these nails won't typically extend the full width of all those studs. So we must ensure that we do specific engineering design of the combination of studs by providing some continuous nailing. What will happen typically is the plywood will be nailed to the outermost stud. The tension hold down is fixed to the innermost stud, and sometimes these internal studs are not connected. So there's a missing part of the load path that's incomplete. Finally, and I won't go through the design of this, for your bottom plate shear connection to the foundation, we will still use the overstrength shear flow to size the internal or the anchors along the length of the bottom plate. So that completes our strength design. To summarize, we're using 2.8 by 60 nails at 100 centers along the ply edges, 9 mm grade F8 plywood sheathing, 3 SG8 90 by 45 studs at each end, and a bracket XHD24. So this is what our wall will look like. Now let's verify the deformations. So delta 1, which is the core deformation due to shear. This is the equation given in the Brand's guide. VI is your shear demand, HI is your wall height, LC is the clear length between your cords, and EA is just the axial stiff sorry, the elastic modulus parallel to grain of your cord and the area of your cord. So all very straightforward variables. Plug it into the equation, we get core deformation due to shear 0.2 millimeters. Delta 2, which is the core deformation due to overturning moment at the top of the wall. Because there is no overturning moment at the top, the moment is zero, therefore delta 2 is zero. For multi-story walls, obviously you will have some overturning moment at the top of the wall at a particular level, and so this will be a non-zero value. Delta 3 is the panel shear deformation. The equation is simply the shear times the height of the wall divided by the shear modulus for grade F8 ply, which is 455 MPa, divided by the thickness, and divided by the thickness of the ply, divided by the length of the wall. That gives us a deformation of 3.9 millimeters. Now, the deformation due to fastener slip, or delta 4. Because we are assuming 1.2 meter by 2.4 meter plywood sheets laid vertically on the wall, that means we won't have any horizontal joints because the height of the sheet equals the height of the wall, but we will need two vertical joints because the sheets are 1.2 wide and we have to make it 3 meters. So we will have N, which is the number of horizontal joints, to be zero, and M, which is the number of vertical joints, to be two. We then have to quantify the stiffness of each nail. So for simplicity, I will adopt the slip modulus approximation from Euro Code 5, which is the equation I showed before. I will use just the density of SG8 and the diameter of the nail as the input, and gives me a serviceability stiffness of 551 newtons per millimeter. I transform that to an ultimate limit state stiffness, by simply multiplying that by 2/3 or 0.67 to give me 367 newtons per millimeter. From there, I plug in the values of slip modulus and number of joints into the equation for delta 4 to give a deformation due to fastener slip of 12.3 millimeters. Next is the deformation of the anchorage system. The equation is given as delta 5, the height times the rotation at the base, and the rotation is the moment divided by the rotational stiffness of your anchorage system. So let's work out KC first. For a stud bank of 3 90 by 45s, our C will be 3 times 45 to give 135, and the height of the bottom plate, which is a single 90 by 45, is 45 millimeters. Because we're at a foundation, we will use the correction factor for continuous supports. And after plugging in those values, we get 0.77. This then means that the stiffness of our compression toe is simply 533 MPa, which is 1/15 of our parallel to grain elastic modulus, times the area of our stud of our cord bank, which is 4 times 45 or 135 times 90, divided by the height of the bottom plate. That all then gets divided by the correction factor of 0.77. The resulting stiffness we get is about 187,000 kilonewtons per meter. As I mentioned in the original table at the work example, let's assume that the manufacturer has supplied us with a tension stiffness of 30,000 kilonewtons per meter. So to calculate our rotational stiffness, we plug in the values of KT, KC, and the length between our cords to give an overall rotation stiffness of 202,000 kilonewton meters per radian. Therefore, the rotation of the wall due to anchorage flexibility is simply the overturning moment divided by that rotational stiffness. From plugging the numbers in, we get a rotation of 0.247 millirads. And the overall deformation due to anchorage system flexibility is then 0.59 millimeters, which is simply the rotation times the height. So because it's a single story wall, delta 6 is 0. And we can now summarize and calculate our total wall elastic displacement. So the wall elastic displacement is simply the sum of all these initial components. And now we are in a position to calculate the ultimate wall displacement. So the ultimate wall displacement is simply the elastic displacement times our ductility of 2 times KDT, which is square root of 2. Because this is a single story building, KD is 1, so no further scaling needs to be applied. Our ultimate wall displacement is then 48 millimeters. So the total wall displacement due to fastener slip, which is the only source of inelastic deformation, is simply the difference between 48 and 17. That gives us 31 millimeters. That's the inelastic component of the total wall displacement due to fastener slip. Therefore, the ultimate wall displacement due to fastener slip is simply delta 4, which is the elastic component, shown here to be 12.4, plus the inelastic component, which is 31.2, to give a total of 43. Now we can check the displacement demand on the nail. This is just a rearrangement of the delta 4 equation originally. By putting in 43.7 as our ultimate nail displacement, plugging the numbers in of number of joints, a number of splices horizontally and vertically, and the length and the height of the wall, we get an ultimate nail local deformation demand of 6.4 millimeters, which exceeds our 6 millimeter displacement limit. So while our strength design was okay, we designed all our CPEs for overstrength. What we're finding is that we are exceeding the deformation capacity of our nails, so our design is not okay. What this then means is this is only iteration one of our design, and that we will have to adjust the nail spacing to reduce the load on each nail. From that, we recalculate our overstrength shear flow, resize our CPEs, recalculate our displacement components, and then recheck the displacement demand to make sure that we are within that 6 millimeter limit. So I won't go through all of that. I've done the work and I've adjusted the fastener spacing to 90 millimeter centers instead of 100. Because of the increase in overstrength shear flow, the hold down connectors had to be upsized. So say for example, the next available bracket is an XHD32 with a capacity of 32 kilonewtons. These are the only components that have changed in our wall assembly from our original strength design. It's important to make sure that you still check all the other components, such as the ply, the cords, the base shear anchors, as well. And reiterating our displacements, the only thing that changes for this example is the deformation due to fastener slip. Because we've tightened the spacing, each nail is now seeing slightly less load and is therefore undergoing slightly less deflection. Technically speaking, if you're picking up a different bracket off the shelf, the stiffness will likely change as well for the stiffness of your anchorage system. So there may be some movement in this value here. Stepping through again all the same calculations that we've just done, we now find that the total displacement in the wall due to nail slip is 40 millimeters, and the local deformation demand within the nail is now 5.9, which is just under our deformation limit. So now our design's okay. So hopefully that illustrates the process of designing a single story wall. It sounds like there's a lot of operations involved, but it's not anything that a simple spreadsheet can't fix. All of the variables are very easily obtainable from either the standard or from supplier technical literature, as well as the geometry that you've got for your specific project and any material properties that you would like to use. Just a quick word about extension to multi-story walls. The same underlying principles apply. So the same equations as they were unmodified can be used, only that we would use the shear and overturning moment demands at every floor. As I mentioned before, the axial forces in the cords are cumulative, so we should be doing a running total of axial force from the top to the bottom of the building. For multi-story buildings, the diaphragm analysis and design will be critical. There is a good discussion of diaphragm analysis and design in the Brands publication, as well as an example in at the end of the book that steps through how you might analyze and design a timber diaphragm. As shown for a single story wall, the deflections can already be significant, and this is even more the case for a multi-story wall. You get additional flexibility from pre-rotation of the supporting walls, as well as your tension stiffness, the effects of your tension stiffness being in series. So a reminder to consider tension connectors in series, and also include the stiffness of your timber floors in your compression toe stiffness calculation. Delta 6 applies for multi-story walls, as mentioned before. And also SLS follows the same approach, but because we're not expecting any yielding in our system, we can use the full stiffness of the fasteners. Finally, something that's not really part of this talk, but worth mentioning is because we've got perpendicular to grain compression over a number of stories, there may be a considerable vertical settlement that might occur, both from elastic loading and from shrinkage. And that's something that should be considered in multi-story analysis and design. Also, because of the flexibility of these walls, multi-story walls particularly, you may get reasonable amplification due to P delta effects. So that is also worth checking. So these are the references that one who is looking to design a plywood shear wall might look to use. Definitely the most one of the better descriptive ones is that multi-story LTF engineering design guide by Brands. 1720 for all the code compliance items, and some additional guidance from the NZ Wood Guides, for example, particularly the seismic design chapter. As mentioned before, there's the Timber Design Journal, particularly a couple of technical notes relating to a worked example for a multi-story wall, as well as some discussion on calibrating or calculating your rotational stiffness for walls. So I would recommend interested readers go into the catalog that the Timber Design Society has online. I hope that was of value to you all, and Thank you, Daniel, for the opportunity to speak, and now I'll open the floor to any questions.
Before we open up the floor for questions, Jay, this was definitely one of the better presentations. I think all of our webinars were pretty good, but this one was outstanding in terms of content and clarity. So thank you so much for your time and preparing the calculated example and the slides. So that was great. And apologies, I think at the introduction I said it won't cover SLS, but obviously it did cover displacements. And in fact, it's one of the governing factors when you have a multi-story building, and definitely something to take care. Now, we have a long list of questions, probably one of the longest as well, considering that tells a little bit that there's some uncertainty on this wall design. So unfortunately, we won't be able to cover all of them. Now, before I read them out to you, I need to say the Brands guideline was written in 2019 before the new standard was published. It covers aspects of the new standard, but it's in part still written on based on the draft, still written based on 3603 in mind. So some factors are not up to date, but I know that David Cardin at Brands and their team are looking at updating the guide. So there will be something new coming. The new standard is not cited yet as such. It's still an alternative solution. So whoever uses the guide and uses the new standard needs to keep that in mind, just as an FYI. Right. Jay, I'm going to read out a few questions. We hopefully can answer them, and the rest we'll have to do at a different time. First, most important question a lot of people ask, are you willing to share your presentation as a PDF further down the track?
Yeah, absolutely. I've got no issues with that.
Perfect. So once that's available, please send it to us and we will upload it to the TDS webpage and people can download it then. Right. Nail distances. There's a question about minimum edge distances when you have a plywood panel joining on a single stud. Obviously, you need to have plywood joints. And it seems that this distance is governing. How have you dealt with it? Is there any way around this limitation?
Sure. I suppose that probably is more of an issue at your internal vertical joints or internal joints in general. What we've previously done for specifically multi-story buildings where we've got quite large shear flows is to use a much wider stud that would relax, I guess, or that will make you able to meet the edge distance both at the end of the stud as well as at the end of the two sheets of ply that are meeting in the middle. So I would suggest if you are concerned about the edges of your internal joins, to just put a couple of internal members, sorry, slightly wider internal members at your joins. If you are using multiple 90 by 45s, for example, at the panel join, definitely consider putting fasteners to connect those two to ensure that there's a reliable load path across that splice.
I've also seen, if I cannot, I've also seen double studs which need to be fixed together, but it adds to the stiffness, well, to the flexibility as well. Another question, which is very pertinent. The new standard says that any ductile or PDE, ductile element PDE, needs to be designed with a detailed connection method. However, nails require ultimate tensile strength to calculate the moment capacity, which is not necessarily provided. How have you dealt with that? And then I can provide a little bit of feedback on the new standard as well.
Yeah, sure. So historically, we've always adopted a nail ultimate tensile strength of 800 MPa. I believe there is an Australian standard 2334 that lays out the nail geometry and nail parameters that you can use in design. So that's typically how we've quantified those values in the detailed method. A calculation of the capacity.
Yeah, it is in fact a bit of an issue that suppliers don't have this value provided, and often the 800 MPa is more for minimum, which is good enough unless you consider overstrength. So it's always good to follow up with suppliers. However, what I want to add here is that the new standard, as we all know, isn't perfect, and the intention was actually that for not only for plywood gusset plates, but also for plywood shear walls and diaphragms, there's an exception. So you don't have to use the detailed method if you don't want to. So moving forward, I recommend you download the suggested errata of the new standard from the Timber Unlimited page, which has this as a as an item. And I know that Timber Unlimited is working on an update or a correction of the standard, which should clarify that a little bit. Right. Let's keep on going with the question. Can you apply the ductility factor to the nail slip component for the drift, given the other wall components aren't yielding and designed for overstrength?
Sorry, am I interpreting that to say that can we scale our wall displacement due to fastener slip, given that the rest of the system is not yielding?
Yes, essentially the question is probably how have you, when you scaled from the elastic demand to the plastic or ultimate demand, could you just multiply the nail slip with the ductility, or do you have to apply it to the whole elastic value?
I mean, that's probably, I don't know if my slides are still sharing.
Yes, they are.
Oh, they are. I'll just quickly go to this slide. So am I understanding the question to be, could we simply just scale this component by the ductility? And the answer is no, because the total displacement is not a function of only the nail slip. It's a function of the sum of all these individual components. So you would first have to sum them to get your total elastic displacement, and then scale it by your modification factors here. And then you work out what the inelastic displacement is, and we are attributing that in our design to only come from fastener slip, which is why we then add that to the elastic component of the fastener slip.
Thank you. No, that's quite clear. Thank you. Another good one. How do we assess the additional wall rotation displacement if the shear wall is fixed onto a beam, steel or timber, without another shear wall directly below it? Have you encountered that, and how have you dealt with that?
So I personally have not, but I have seen an approach in literature, and it's basically first principles. You quantify the stiffness of your beam both at the compression and the tension end, and those feed into the overall flexibility of your system. The approach for Delta 5 should always be at a system level. And as far as I know, there are no straightforward closed form equations that you can directly use for walls landing onto a beam.
There probably are some that are probably too complex. So I agree with your first principle approach. It's quite straightforward. Do you find your walls struggle to work to satisfy the flexion criteria with the addition of the KDT factor?
My experience is definitely yes. The KDT is quite punishing, especially for moderately ductile structures. However, it is sort of a very straightforward implementation, acknowledging of the phenomenon that there is a pinched hysteretic response for timber structures, and there is reduced energy dissipation that can occur. So it's more of a playing around with your wall distribution, I think, more than anything, to control the amount of demand, first of all, that you are assigning to the individuals, to then consequently dial back your displacements. Alternatively, you might look to explore a lower level of ductility so that the amplification to your demands will be slightly reduced. But again, you end up having the capacity design still, and you might end up trying to catch your tail.
Correct. What I would like to add here, the KDT factor was presented in the draft of 1720.1 and was now removed. It is, however, still in the brand's guideline and also in the NZ Wood guideline. Now, it is a very simplified and potentially conservative approach. However, there isn't anything simpler available at the moment. So if someone doesn't want to use the KDT factor, one can do displacement-based design or RDRS. But at the moment, there isn't enough information available for a simplified method. So I recommend this factor being used, but the years, over the next years, hopefully more information on this will come. Now, Jay, there's probably two questions now in terms of clarification on the slides. One is, when you calculate the overstrength shear flow, there was an S, so the spacing potentially missing in the equation. Now, if you're able to find it quickly, we could clarify. If not, it could be clarified when you then upload the slides. I didn't pick that one specifically up.
Is it this S here?
Potentially, yes.
So I guess this represents that same term there, which is the capacity divided by the spacing, which represents that 6.8.
Yeah.
But I take your point. I think what's probably missing here is the K17 instead, because we've added that later on. The trouble with using the European yield model is all your factors are incorporated to your embedment, and you end up getting a value at the end with the strength reduction factor to your for your steel and for your timber are already incorporated into that value. So it's a little bit hard to itemize every other factor that's fed into that.
The 1.2 is actually just right off your cursor, and it says K17 is 1.2. So it's probably just not spelled out in the equation, but done correctly. So yeah, that clarifies.
Clarify that.
Yeah. No, thanks, Jay. The other question was, you mentioned that you're taking 72 kilonewton with a 90 by 45 SG8, but I think immediately after you mentioned that you have actually tripled up your studs. So I think that covers that aspect here.
Yeah, so I think what I tried to show here is the single capacity of a single stud is 72. And then later on, if we've got three studs, then our total compression capacity is three times that.
Yeah, no, perfect. Now there's other, they're all really good questions. So I really enjoy this session here. You talked mostly about nails providing the ductility of your shear wall. What are your thoughts about using screws instead to provide the ductility in between the plywood and the studs?
So I personally have not used screws in that application, and it is my understanding that screws are still largely unregulated in New Zealand. So there is quite a lot of uncertainty in terms of, I mean, you could argue the same for nails, I guess, to an extent, but there are a lot of very high strength screws out there. And in terms of doing a capacity design where we want to accurately quantify the maximum strength able to be developed at these fasteners, it would be it would probably introduce a lot of uncertainty into our design in using screws. I'm not saying that it can't be done. Probably from a first principle standpoint, it could be applied, but you would really want to know the capacity of the fasteners that you're putting in, as well as their ability to dissipate energy and whatever displacement limits might apply to screws as well.
Yeah, no, I fully agree with your sentiment. I would not recommend using off-the-shelf screws in New Zealand because it's mainly due to manufacturing of the screws. They're obviously rolled or whatever other form of machining, which hardens, essentially makes the screw hard, and they have a brittle failure mode. Some of the European screws, which have ETAs, are potentially more ductile, but with such small diameters, I think I would be quite cautious. Brass nails and staples, staple being the other potential solution, provide some quite stable local ductility.
And maybe to add to that as well, Daniel, there is quite a good capability within the New Zealand market to prefabricate nailed plywood sheathing as well, which might also make it easier from a construction standpoint to supply these walls.
Yeah, and I think installing nails is so much simpler and quicker than installing thousands of screws. Now, another related question to the nails now, and I probably know where it's coming from. A lot of these prefabricators use D-shaped nails rather than the full circle nails. What is your thought on this aspect, Jay?
So I understand that in 3603, we used to get an improvement in strength due to using flathead nails. I believe that's since gone from our move into 1720. I personally don't fully know what the consequence might be for adopting a slightly different nail geometry. I would expect that the rope effect, although it's sensitive to the type of nail or nail shank that you use, I don't believe there is a specific method to calculate their capacity in 1728 for different kinds of heads. Or correct me if I'm wrong, Daniel.
Yeah. So my take is the flathead nails we have in 3603, they're no longer in use. These are the ones which are installed by hand. All the new heads have a smaller head and don't provide the same level of fixity, the head fixity. That's why essentially this very large 1.4 came in. Moving forward, the 1720 nail capacity is actually larger than we have in 3603, which makes up of the shortfall. And the standard recommends a 1.1 factor rather than 1.4, which is more aligned with the new shape of the head of the nail, which is either round or D-shaped, but they're typically smaller than the round flat ones. So that's how I would approach it. Russ, if you want to use the new detailed method, all of these geometrical aspects are actually in the equation, so this factor no longer applies as such. Right, Jay, I don't know how long you're willing to keep going. The list doesn't seem to be get smaller because every time I read a question, a new one comes in. So I probably do a few more, and then we'll see if we can go back inviting to some of those outstanding questions.
Sure.
You seem to have used Eurocode equations to determine the slip modulus rather than the equations in 1720.1. Is there a reason, and do you have any further thoughts on this question?
Yeah, for sure. So I've used here the Eurocode formulation for the slip modulus simply for brevity. It's a very small equation. It's very easy to implement. You could very much use the New Zealand standard one, which probably actually suits a New Zealand context better. But the calculation of the curve is probably a little bit more involved for this format. I would suggest that if you're doing detailed design, definitely do use the 1720 formulation for deformations as a starting point, but absolutely run a sensitivity check. So what you will find is your deformations are quite sensitive to the slip modulus that you adopt. And so run a sensitivity check to make sure that if you were to say vary the value of or the stiffness that you use in your design, that your overall global and local displacement demands are still satisfactory.
Thanks for that. So I'm reading to some of the questions, and I might jump in just to keep it also simple. There's a few questions about why don't we use P21 rated walls? Why don't we use walls rated to EWPAA or the Australian equivalent of 3604? Now, this topic has been ongoing, and I want to put a bit of a line in the sand here. It's quite simple. P21 rated walls are it's an approach which is for 3604 buildings, so 1 to 2 level plywood or chip rated lined walls, which have been tested, which are specifically done for low risk buildings. P21 is not adequate for anything which is not 3604. And if someone really needs to put the engineering hat on to clarify, and there's some guidance from Engineer New Zealand on that matter. So please do not use P21 rated systems on any multi-story timber building. That's my take. And Jay, I'm happy if you want to add your thoughts on this one. But I
No.
just feel that we as an industry need to be quite careful what we're doing.
100% agree.
Thank you. Maybe I do the last two questions. The number of questions doesn't go down, so I probably we need to stop somewhere. If the overstrength demand is greater than the elastic cutoff load demand, can you adopt the elastic cutoff demand instead of the overstrength to the CPE elements?
So 1720 allows you to do that, but I would exercise caution, and there's been I think advice from CSOC that was issued maybe end of last year to do with these elastic cutoffs that are allowed by the code. If you are intending to design something ductile, then you want to be very clear what your mechanism is, where your yielding occurs, and you want to ensure that anywhere else that's not yielding is designed for overstrength. If you apply the elastic cutoff, you're artificially reducing the demand on that element in the context of if your nails actually yield, and you run the risk of your studs, for example, if you design them for elastic actions instead of overstrength, you run the risk of them failing first before your fasteners reach the intended level of ductility. So while it is allowed, definitely exercise caution in understanding how much your margin above overstrength might be. And there was a technical note in the last timber design journal, I think from Tobias, which discusses that very, very clearly.
Yeah, I was actually following up on that. Please have a look at the latest tech note. And I think changes to the standard to 1720.1 might come in. Very, very simple question, Jay, before we conclude. There's a question. If you have an internal plywood splice over a stud, do you need to design that for your shear flow, essentially?
So if it's a continuous member, because the shear flow is an internal force, it sort of cancels out from one side of the splice to the other. So
I think it's about the nailing itself.
oh, the nailing, okay. So if you're joining two members at a splice, for example, is that the question?
Yes, yeah.
Then yes, yeah, I would. You have to have a load path from one side of the splice to the other, so you have to bridge that gap. And to be consistent with our initial design assumption of only the nails around the edges yielding, we should be providing anything else within that system. We should be designing them for overstrength actions, so designing them as CPEs.
All right. I think we stop here now with all the questions. Apologies for the one which haven't been answered. We will try to follow up on them. There's just not enough time to cover all of them. Jay, there were a lot of comments as well, thanking you for the great presentation, and I can only join them in thanking you for this very important topic. And thanks for your time and patience for yeah, again, preparing it and talking us through. And based on the feedback, I think there's more work to be done in the next year, and TDS will take that on board. Having said that, thanks everyone for attending. Jay, thanks again. And I wish everyone a very good break, and I'll see you all in the new year. Thank you very much.